Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Better Side of the Mountain in the Ramsey Center at Western Carolina University for the Catamount All-Access pregame show presented by TV62. I'm Caleb Rutherford alongside Jake Myers, and today we have a Southern Conference matchup between your Western Carolina Catamounts and the Wofford Terriers. Now, Jake, Western got off to one of its best conference starts in history at 4-1, but they've gone 2-5 since then. They did win a few nights ago against Georgia Southern. Things appear to be going well in the beginning, but what happened?
Well, they just couldn't close out games. We saw them against Elon at home a couple weeks ago, and they had a lead at halftime. They were in control of that game, but defensively they got let down, and they lost that game. They went to Appalachian State a week ago. They were down, but they came back, they fought, they scratched, they clawed, but they still couldn't get it done. They just couldn't close out the games, and they got down too early. Now, I don't know what Larry Hunter tells his guys. I don't know if they're going to right the ship right away, but we saw this last year. We saw this happen last year. They made a run, 8 straight games to finish out the season, plus the run through the SoCon tournament to the championship, where they eventually lost, but right on schedule this time. They just beat Georgia Southern, and now they're back at home. They have a team in Wofford where they have a chance to beat. They have a very good chance to beat Wofford. And right now, we'll see what they can do.
All right, now, one of the things that I've personally questioned with the Catamounts is I can't tell if this team has an identity. Jake, does this team have an identity, and does it need one to be successful?
Well, it's hard to say at this point because we all know that Trey Sumler, the point guard, the star guard for Western Carolina, is the offense. Everything runs through Trey. He plays almost the entire game, every single game. The kid has to be in good shape. But we see that Western can beat teams in many different ways. It depends on what the defense gives them. They can go inside to Towoski team. Brandon Boggs has been playing great of late. Jameson Sclair has come into his own this year. And we've seen glimpses of Tankiewicz hitting threes all over the place. So right now it's a wing-dominated team. But inside, Towoski and Preston Ross coming off the bench can really do some damage. But it all depends on what the defense gives them.
Certainly something to look at going forward. Lately, the Catamounts haven't been using their bench players much. Only Mike Brown and Preston Ross, like you mentioned, have gotten playing time in every game. They've played 24 games. Only Preston and Mike Brown that aren't starting have played in every game. Rhett Harrelson's played in 21 games. And then Kenny Hall and Josh Mendenhall played in 17 games. And that's not including their minutes, which hasn't been much, to put it bluntly. Do you think that's causing a problem? Do you think the team might be running out of gas?
Well, maybe. You see the starters going up to 30 minutes or more for all of them. Trey, like I said, plays almost the entire game. And it's really hard because when you're not winning the game and you have to take the players out because they're tired and you throw someone in who doesn't play a lot, they're not fresh and they're not in tune with what's going on the floor. Now, we've seen times where Rhett Harrelson comes in and does very well. He doesn't turn the ball over, plays really solid defense. All of these guys can play defense. Larry Hunter preaches that. Offensively, some of them are a little suspect. Torian Brummett's still not in his zone yet. Mendenhall has shown glimpses but hasn't played that much. So has Kenny Hall. But at the same time, they need to get guys more involved in the game to give these guys breathers. And we saw that against Appalachian State. We saw Brummett come in a couple times. Mm-hmm. Harrelson came in, and they did a very good job. They just have to continue to orient them within the offense.
Now, you mentioned Towoski King. Towoski is Western's big man at 6'8", and he's had to deal with guys much taller than him. Davidson in particular had a couple of guys that were 6'10". And Wofford's tallest guy is also 6'8". Do you think that that gives Towoski an advantage because he's used to playing guys that are bigger than him?
Well, it does. I mean, he is used to playing guys that are 6'10", 6'11", sometimes even 7 feet in this conference. There's not many of those guys out there, but every team has at least one, and he's always matched up on them. Luckily for Towoski, though, he's always the bigger of the guy, of the two guys. But in this matchup, he's going to face Aris Smith, who's about his same size, 6'8", 250. Aris Smith is a big man. He doesn't really get a lot of points production, but he does get a lot of rebounds. So Towoski has an advantage because he's always bigger, but this body that he's going to go up against tonight, Aris Smith, might give him a little bit of trouble because he's a little bit bigger.
Certainly Aris Smith's size has to contribute on their defense as they do have the best scoring defense in the conference. However, that is matched up with the worst scoring offense. Certainly not a formula that leads to much success. Now, we talked about Wofford. Let's talk about them for a second. 12 of their 14 players are freshmen or sophomores. That's pretty impressive that they've been able to field a team like that. But at the collegiate level where these kids have been playing basketball their whole life, and now, you know, they're getting into their 19, 20 years old where it should become kind of natural to them, is being a freshman or sophomore in college as big a deal as it is maybe at some of the lower levels?
Well, I mean, I don't know if it's as big of a deal as it is in lower levels, but it's still a huge leap. I mean, if you're going from playing your whole life, it's a different type of game. The tempo's different. The style's different. And you haven't played with these guys before. If you come in as a freshman like Spencer Collins has and – he's basically with guys he's never played before, but you got to get used to each other. They build chemistry. These guys are very young, like you said, but they've beaten good teams, and they're only 10-15 on the year, 4-8 in the conference, but they've beaten good teams. They've tested good teams in the conference with such young guys that if they continue to build on each other and continue to figure out each other's strengths and weaknesses, it can really be a positive in the end.
And you talked about them being young. They did beat Xavier at Xavier by 1 point. That's a very impressive victory for them. Now, one of those sophomores that we mentioned is talented guard Carl Cochran. Talk about his play a little bit for the Terriers this year.
Well, he was the 2012 SoCon Freshman of the Year and has led the team in scoring in 10 games this season. Now, he's only 6'1". He's out of Marietta, Georgia, but he's averaging 15 points a game. That is ridiculous in this conference, especially considering the likes of Davidson and College of Charleston, which they have played. And I don't know what he does. He just has such a complete game. He can dribble drive. He can shoot. He can penetrate. And he's a pretty unselfish guy. And he's probably gonna see some double teams tonight against Western with the likes of Trey, and then maybe help from Brandon Boggs, or maybe even Kowalski when he gets into the lane.
Very talented, as we said, only a sophomore. Now, Jake, what are your keys to the game tonight? And realistically, I personally believe the Catamounts can pull this one off, but do you think they can pull it off?
I do think they think they can pull it off. Now, Wofford, they're only 2-12 on the road this year. Not a very good away from their home place. But if you look at some of the stats here from the conference, Western and Wofford are 1-2 respectively in steals in the conference. And like you said, Wofford is the number one scoring defense in the conference. Now, some of their weaknesses, however, offensive rebounding. The Catamounts have done very well offensive rebounding. Now, defensively, Wofford can rebound, but we are so active on the boards that it might cause them a little bit of trouble. So I look for them to out-rebound the Wofford Terriers and try to contain Cochran and not let him get going, because Adam Cochran and their freshman Spencer Collins, there's not another guy who's really going to hurt you. So they just have to contain those two guys and score a lot of points, because as we know, Wofford only scores 59 a game, and if they can do that, they should pull out a win.
Do you think that them being a 2-12 road team has to do with their youth, or is that just a flaw in the team in general?
Well, I think it would have to be a youth kind of deal. Like you said, there's only two guys that aren't freshmen or sophomores on this team, and they haven't really played together. They're not used to everything yet, because as you know, more experience yields better production. Now, they'll get it right. They've improved the past couple years, and as you know, with a young team, if you develop the guys consistently, they can turn into something really great. So right now, youth is a problem, but at the same time, it's also a bright spot, and if they can build on it, they can cause problems for teams in the SoCon in the upcoming years.
All right, that'll do it for our pregame show here. We're going to take a break. When we come back, Kyle Rush and Ryan Keyes will have the call of the Wofford Terriers versus your Western Carolina Catamounts. You've been watching the Catamount All Access pregame show presented by TV62.
Charlie was a recognized advocate for education in Western North Carolina who worked tirelessly to help Jackson County become a better place for all of its citizens. A career 52% shooter, he scored 1,018 career points for the Catamounts during his career from 1963 through 1966, a mark that continues to rank 39th in WCU's record books. In 2003, he was inducted into the WCU Athletics Hall of Fame as a member of the 1963 NAIA National Runner-Up Western Carolina team. Fans, at this time, we ask that you please pause for a moment of silence in memory of Dr. Charlie McConnell. Fans, thank you. Now let's meet the starting lineups for tonight's game. First for the visiting Terriers. Starting at point guard, a 6-foot sophomore from Marietta, Georgia, number 2, Carl Cochran. And another guard, a 6-4 sophomore from Sydney, Australia, number 11, Indiana Faithful. And a third guard, a 6-4 freshman from Easley, South Carolina, number 32, Spencer Collins. And a forward, a 6-8 junior from Charlotte, North Carolina, number 14, Aris Smith. And at the other forward, a 6-6 sophomore from Lombard, Illinois, number 34, Lee Skinner. The Terriers head coach is Mike Young. The associate head coach is Paul Harrison, assisted by Gus Hauser, Matt Morris, and Cameron Rundles.
And we welcome you to Western Carolina for the SoCon Showdown between the Wofford Terriers and the Catamounts. I'm Kyle Rush along with Ryan Keyes. And Ryan, that win Saturday has a lot of opportunity to spark this team for a late season push, much like a year ago.
Big game here tonight, Kyle. We've got two teams who are both trying to hit their stride right now. Wofford's got two straight wins, but they're 4-8 in the SoCon. They've got to get to work. They're a little bit behind what they usually are. For the Cats, like you said, last year was a year where they started off kind of slow. They got hot. Right now, big win. They're 6-6 in the SoCon, not out of things at all. This is a big game for both teams.
The issue with the Catamounts, they've been in a lot of games, especially here at home, have not been able to play 40 solid minutes. We'll see if they can do that today as Towoski King gets set to jump it up for the Catamounts, and we are underway. Sumler has the ball in the backcourt. And maybe an X factor tonight, Ryan, is Brandon Boggs coming off a 19-point game in Statesboro, Georgia on Saturday.
Boggs averaging 10.5 points a game. His offensive numbers have gone up a little bit since last year. A little more consistency from him this year, Kyle.
Tankowitz will spot up for three. First one is good. A good sign if you're a fan of the purple and gold.
Certainly. I mean, if you can get Tom Tankowitz going from beyond the arc, that is huge for this offense, and that has been their main struggle this year is getting some points. So if Tom can get going, that's big.
1 of 5 from downtown on Saturday. He's 1-1 so far tonight. Faithful into the front court. And now the Terriers will work their offense as Cochran came to get it. Faithful almost had it poked from behind. Shot clock down to 3. Wofford's got to put up a tough shot. Off the front iron, no good. Tankowitz the rebound.
A lot of patience there for the Terriers. They just couldn't find a shot.
Credit the Catamount defense there. Now Sumler calls out the offense, and the Catamounts get set to go to work. Sinclair Fields now dribble with the right hand, spin move into the paint. Tankowitz will drive the lane. Nowhere to go, he finds King. Shot clock under 10. King, a jump hook, won't go. But Ryan, that's an area where he's really elevated his game on the low block, finding different ways to finish underneath.
That's exactly right. Again, another guy that's in double digits as the Terriers score right there. You're talking 11.7 points a game from a big man. Not too bad, and it definitely adds another wrinkle to this Catamounts offense.
As Cochran hits the triple for Wofford, we're tied at 3. 18 to go here in the first half. Double comes to King. Now he's 1-on-1 and he'll go to work. Drop steps, too strong off the window. Wanted a foul, didn't get it. And early on, Ryan, you can tell it's a point of emphasis from Coach Hunter to get the ball inside to the big fella.
Something pointed out in the pregame is the fact that these are two guys that are around 6'8 going up against each other. Towoski used to playing bigger players, and they might be looking for a mismatch opportunity here. If you're used to playing guys that are 7 foot, you can go up against a 6'8 guy and have some success, but he's got to find the net.
Faithful foul going to the rack, and 90% free throw shooter. And what a story he is. Entered the season as the third point guard on the depth chart. Due to injuries for the Terriers, he's now starting. And talking with some of the Wofford guys beforehand, he's really started to develop in that role and been a big part of their wins at Elon and UNCG.
Also a transfer student out of Sydney, Australia, a long way from Wofford. Don't quite know how he found that college, but having some success here on the starting lineup.
He goes 1-2. It's good enough to give the Terriers a 4-3 early lead. Sinclair will try from long range. He got it. Catamounts shooting well from downtown early.
You want to talk about an X factor, Kyle. That might be your guy. Sinclair was an excellent defensive player last year. He's extended it to the offensive touch this year, and he's a fabulous young player.
Cochran will pull up. This one got blocked. Tankowitz, another rebound. And that's an area where he's really shined as of late. When he's not even shooting the ball well, he's doing a lot of good things on the glass.
Picked up the loose ball, but talking about Sinclair's defense, there it is right there with the tip.
King backs his way down, forces it, can't get it to go. Rattled around the rim and out. He's 0 for 3 early on in this one.
I think you just got to keep on feeding the ball, Kyle. He's getting decent looks. They're going to fall at some point.
Pull up jumper, that one will go.
Spencer Collins.
And Collins did a nice job off that ball screen and knocked down the open look.
Freshman seemed to float in the air forever right there on the jump before knocking it down. Nice play.
And the King back out. Boggs thought about it. Now he'll drive. Sinclair pump fake. He'll get his spot in and out won't go. Boggs, the hustle play with a rebound. Back up, that won't go. Loose ball on the floor. Sinclair comes away with it. Tankiewicz again. No, Sinclair, yes! The offensive glass. Three extra possessions, and it resulted in 2 points for the purple and gold.
Gotta love the effort there from the Cats. A lot of hustle plays there, and it looked early like Boggs passed up a good shot, but they kept on working at it, got the two.
50-50 ball. The Catamounts came away with that one. Now, somewhere a steal. One on two. Hangs in the air, can't get it to go. And what a move by Indiana Faithful. Yeah. Now he's in the break. Kick out Cochran. Hanger won't go. King the rebound. And so a couple of wild possessions and somewhere will slow it down.
Cochran's got to take that shot off the pass, but I'll tell you, I'm not only impressed by Indiana's move right there, but the ability to stay with Sumler on the break. That was some beautiful defense.
Sinclair now pulls it out. Nearing the 15-minute mark, the Catamounts a two-point lead. Sumler for three. The Catamounts lighting it up from downtown, but you could argue it's trying to set up that inside game that set that up early on.
That's exactly right, Kyle, and that's what the Cats probably should have been doing early in the season. If you can get it inside and they double, you've got open guys on the outside. They're passing very well here in this game.
11-6, an early five-point advantage for the Catamounts. Faithful comes around the ball screen. Wofford not able to do much with it. Shot clock again down inside of 10 seconds. Nice pass, and he's fouled on the way up. What beautiful artistry by Lee Skinner as he fed it inside. And Wofford will get a trip to the line.
A little deceptiveness there. Kept it low and put it right on the money, and the defense just couldn't read it.
That'll lead us to our first timeout. Catamounts with an 11-6 lead. When you come back, Wofford will be in the line. Welcome back to the Ramsey Center, and early on it has been a very efficient start to this Catamount offensive attack.
Certainly, it all starts with the passing, Kyle, and working the ball inside. They're having Preston Ross come in for Chwosky. Watch out for Ross. I want to see this kid get more minutes because he is a freak of an athlete.
Preston Ross checks into the ball game, and as you mentioned, he is a freak and can jump out of the gym from anywhere. He had a really big ball game, doing a lot of the little things, a couple huge dunks in that game against Georgia Southern as well. But Smith that in the line for Wofford. He hits the first. Smith on the season, only a 52% free throw shooter. But he gets the first here to cut the lead to four.
Smith and Tawoski really about the same size, not only in height, they're both 6'8", but muscular-wise, I mean, he's ripped. But Tawoski's got some strength, too. That'll be an interesting matchup throughout the game.
So the 52% free throw shooter gets them both the 90% split for the Terriers, and that one's over the backboard and out of play. But again, the Catamounts got a really clean look at a jump shot.
Definitely a good look. I don't mind that shot at all. He just knows that he can hit those, and I mean, not a lot of people harder on Trey Sumler than Trey Sumler. He sees that ball. He knows he's got a good shot. He doesn't make it. He's frustrated with himself.
And how about this defensively for Coach Hunter? Catamounts, full court pressure early on.
Maybe
Wofford gets the ball in. Wofford's into the front court. Shot clock down to 20. Tankiewicz almost another steal. And the fourth straight year, Ryan, this team in the Catamounts is leading the Southern Conference in steals.
Well, it's a focus, and I think the athleticism of the team really gives them that. But it's not just athleticism. You have to have a lot of anticipation. Some of those steals are going to come off of passes, and you're just getting your hand in front of them. I mean, this is a defensive type of team. That is what Larry Hunter has wanted. That's what he's created. And if they can find out some offense in the meantime, they can go deep.
Tankiewicz had a look, saw it late, but the deflection goes out of bounds. So the Catamounts will keep it here. And Mike Brown will check into the ball game for Sinclair.
Brown, a solid ball player, got some playing time when Tank had to sit out a game earlier in the season. He can make some plays. He wants the ball, too.
Into Ross. Ross looking to go one-on-one. Double comes. Now he's in trouble. Almost walked with it. And finally gets it out to Brown. He's got to shoot. Sumler can't get it away. And Coach Hunter, more than anything, I think he's more upset at the unawareness from Brown at the shot clock.
Boggs and Sumler having a bit of a conversation there, but I don't think Boggs realizes that by the time Sumler got that ball, the clock's already down. I mean, that's got to be – you got to be aware. If you're Ross, if you're Brown, you have to be aware of what the shot clock is.
And just like that, Mendenhall's going to the scorer's table. So Coach Hunter obviously not pleased with something, but Mendenhall's the guy that saw a considerable more amount of minutes Saturday than – most are accustomed to him seeing. Coach Hunter thinks he has a lot of potential, especially defensively, for this ball club.
I've seen the kid in practice. He does have a lot of potential, but a lot of people thought that potential was going to come out this year, and so far we haven't seen a whole lot of it.
Brown got the possession back on the extra hustle, and it was almost turned over again. Mendenhall come in along with King. Catamount's a big lineup here with Mendenhall, King, Ross, Brown, and Sumler on the floor.
Maybe looking to work that inside game again, Kyle.
Brown triggers the inbounds pass to Sumler. Cochran on him. Shot clock at 15 as Sumler looks at the offensive set. King catches it high post. Brown baseline, skip pass. Ross, you better believe it. Pretty, pretty basketball as they set it up with a drive on the baseline.
Much better play there by Brown. Perfect pass selection, and Ross knows what to do with it when he's got an open lane like that.
Catamounts lead back up to three. Wofford had cut it to one. It's 13-10, under 12 to go. Comes around, three ball on the way. Won't go, tip will go. A nice follow that time from Skinner. And the lead back down to one as no one was able to get a body on him coming down the lane for the offensive board.
Yeah, you'd like to see Tawoski box out there, but he wasn't able to get in position.
Sumler gets the floater to go, and that's his move, Ryan. When he's able to split and get in the lane and shoot that little short jump shot, he is so, so good.
Trying to fire up his team there afterwards. Good thing that he made the shot because it wasn't the best shot selection in the world, but it is one that he can hit.
Now Wofford trying to drive in on Ross, absorbs contact, and now Wofford will set it up again, 11 to go. Drive to the lane, Cochran can't get it to go with a little English, and now Sumler realizes he doesn't have numbers, backs it up. Ross takes it in right at him, dumped to King, almost lost the handle, but recovers in time. He goes to the floor, and it'll be a Catamount turnover.
Official timeout.
The lead is 3 at 15-12, 10:47 to go first half. Wofford ball when you come back to Catamount All Access presented by TV62. And we welcome you back to the Ramsey Center. It'll be Wofford basketball. But early on, pretty even numbers, both sides shooting at 40% from the floor. But the difference is the Catamounts, 3 of 5 from long range. They're really taking advantage from downtown.
Part of it also generating more opportunities. Offensive rebounds, they've got 5 right now, and that is a big difference. That gets you 4 more shots compared to Wofford's 1 offensive rebound.
The concern for the Catamounts, 4 early turnovers. Or 2, I beg your pardon. They have 4 assists. Terriers have only turned it over once thus far. Cochran comes around the screen. He's doubled. Finds the open man. They swing it around nicely. But even better recovery defense from the Catamounts. Cochran a wild drive. Ross almost had the steal. Faithful skip pass. Shot clock down to 3. Cochran, 4-3, bang! They used the shot clock and finally got a good look.
Catamounts defense fell behind there. Ross almost helped them get back into position by tipping that first pass, but they never really got back into position, and that left that shooter open as the shot clock went down.
Some were lobbing, and King double comes, doesn't matter. He's too deep, and when he catches the ball on the low block like that, almost impossible to stop him from putting it home.
Oh, especially when you're shorter than he is. I mean, those are two of the, I'd hate to say smaller because they're still pretty big players, but two of the smaller players on Wofford trying to take on Tawoski.
Catamount lead back up to 2, 17-15, 9.5 to go. Cochran comes to the ball. He'll try it again. A heat check. That won't go. Sumler now will bring it across. Double comes to him. He'll swing it. Mendenhall on Jones. And Mendenhall had it knocked away as he was going up. Good defense from Faithful that time. As 3 Catamounts at the scores table set to check in. Next dead ball in Sinclair, Boggs, and Tankowitz. Shot clock down to 5 as King gets it in the post. Sumler for 3, in and out, won't go.
Sumler holding onto the ball a little too long. The way that this Catamounts team built the lead was passing plays, ball movement. Now they're starting to get to a point where you're holding onto the ball for 15 seconds at a time.
Hammered inside is Skinner. He'll go back to the free throw line.
Got my foul number 32, Tawoski.
The foul will be on King, his first.
It's the 13th foul.
But Kyle, to kind of dig deeper on what's going on at the other end, you send it to Tawoski, but you give it to him with 8 seconds left. He tries to post up, but as soon as the double team comes, well, he wants to pass out. The problem is when he passes out, there's only 3 seconds left on the clock at that point. I mean, start moving the ball sooner if they're not giving you driving lanes.
Skinner missed the first. Gordon and Collins will come in for Wofford.
Number 24, Brandon Boggs. And number 25, James
to counter the Sinclair. Substitutions of Tankowitz, Boggs, and Sinclair. Harrelson also coming in for Trey. He'll take a seat. So, other than King, everybody switched out on the Catamount sideline. 4 new players into the ballgame. And Rhett Harrelson, a guy you really, really like.
I like Harrelson a lot. He's an effort player, and he makes good plays. He's a smart player. He can shoot from the outside. I mean, they're putting it in capable hands, giving Trey a little rest here.
And that's an area where Coach Hunter feels like he might have a luxury with Harrelson this year as opposed to last year, especially getting into tournament time, where you can rest a guy like Trey Sumler for a couple minutes. 10 on the shot clock. They'll swing it around. Harrelson calls a play. Catamount's got to hurry. Only 3 on the clock. Sinclair realizes it. Fadeaway jumper. Can't get it to go.
Official
timeout. Wofford's defense starting to stand tall. They trail by 2 here at the Ramsey Center.
They'll be hosting the Washington State Cougars. The series begins this Friday, February 15th at 4 p.m. at Hennett Stadium. Come out and support the Catamount baseball team. You can get game and ticket information online at catamountsports.com.
We'll be right back.
And we welcome you back to the Ramsey Center. And Ryan, Wofford's defense really starting to make their presence felt, especially on the perimeter.
Wofford's defense starting to play a lot better. However, I think if you're the Cats, you got to go back to where you started when you were scoring points. A lot of ball movement, work the ball inside, work it in there early, and that way if they double Tawoski, which they've been doing quite a bit, he can work it back outside to the open jump shooter. They have a lot of good three-point shooters on the floor right now.
The Lady Cats also playing Wofford tonight, but they're in Spartanburg, South Carolina. They lead by one, 40-39, 3.5 to go in that one. Catamounts up two here with 7:40 to go on the men's side from the Ramsey Center. Wofford having a tough time getting anything going, and they'll call a foul. And a foul that might have bailed out a Wofford offense.
Okay, I was wondering if they called it on Sinclair for a second. I was about to say he missed. You mentioned steals, though, earlier from this team, and just watch the way that Sinclair plays, constantly throwing his hands out, looking to tip anything, and that's how they're getting it. It's aggression on defense.
That foul was called on King, his second. And the Catamount defense forces a turnover, but King's got to be really careful not to pick up number three before the midterm break.
Yeah, I mean, we just talked about aggression on defense. Tawoski got his hand caught in the cookie jar, as they say, and sometimes that happens when you're like that, but then sometimes plays like that with the turnover happen as well.
Boggs drives, floater.
Boggs.
And Boggs has really started to come on late in the season. At about the midway point, a nice jumper there, and it extends the Catamount lead back to four.
He took it right to him and then nailed the shot. He's got confidence right now.
Now he's got the steal. Jump stop, turn, and he's fouled. He'll go to the line. He got popped in the mouth as he hit the deck hard. But how about the play from Boggs? He gets a nice jumper going right at him, as you alluded to. Then he gets the steal, and now he's at the free throw line.
Tough play there by Boggs, and you want to ignite your team. You see that you had a lead. It's starting to dwindle away a little bit. How do you ignite your team? You make big plays on both sides of the court. That's exactly what he's doing right now.
Nails the first free throw.
Faithful
and
Sumler back out there.
And Box has his third point in two possessions.
Faithful and Sumler back out there. That's turned into quite an interesting matchup already on both ends of the court.
Sumler with five early points. Faithful only with one, but he's caused a lot of havoc defensively.
He's hanging in there. He's getting space on offense as well, even though he's not gotten a lot of points yet. I mean, he's going toe-to-toe with Sumler. He's been pretty good.
Give him credit for an assist as well. Well, short on that one is Tankiewicz. Another rebound. How about Tankiewicz? His fourth board coming with 6.5 to go here in the first half. King jump shot. The big fella puts it home on the inside. And the lead, just like that, is up to 8.
Putting the work in on that post game offensively. He's already a good rebounder, but he's getting better and better at putting points on the board.
Catamounts have their largest lead of the day. And now another steal. Pass ahead. Sumler's got to work to run it down. Throws it all the way back into the backcourt. Tawoski King runs it down. And then Boggs can't hang on to it. Wofford in the break, and they'll finish it with a flush. So Wofford had had three straight offensive possessions with turnovers. That streak ends on an emphatic dunk on a pass on the outlet that was too far and led to the Wofford break.
Tank looking for a call there, but as far as I know, he just airballed that.
23-17, 5.5 to go, first half. Nice cut inside, tough finish, can't get it to go. Sinclair the board. And he'll slow it down as he realizes he doesn't have numbers. Sinclair, jab left, kick right. And Boggs slows it down. And they'll reset the offense. 20 on the shot clock. Boggs, he'll take the jumper. Won't go. Sumler got knocked down onto the paint. And now Wofford, another chance to cut into the lead. Drive, middle of the lane, right-handed finish, well done. And Bird finished with the right hand, not what a coach may want. You want to finish with the left, but he gets it to go.
He got it to go. He took a little bit of contact from Tank, but the refs are letting him play right now. So at this point, you got to assume that you have to make the shot and you're not going to get a foul.
The lead down to four. Tankowitz, oh, nice pass that time. And now the assignment to Sumler is solely on Collins. Sumler looking to take him, and miscommunication results in another Catamount turnover. Brown will check in. And Cochran will come back in for the Terriers.
A little bit of frustration going on right now. Sumler's got to recognize that they are double teaming him. They're not, they're disguising it, but they are double teaming him. Tank's open right there. He doesn't get him the ball nearly early enough. And again, holding on to the basketball. You've got to be able to pass if they're going to double team you, because you're not going to drive to the net.
The turnover is the Catamount's fourth. Yeah, they still lead by four with four to go here in the first half. Cochran finds a wide open man. Kick out three. Won't get it to go, and those are the type of shots you got to make on the road.
The Cat's fortunate there.
Sumler will find the trailer. Tankowitz from way outside can't quite get it to go. We've seen Keaton Cole hit a few from way back there. Tom can't get it to go that time.
Bit of a challenge shot, too. I think he thought he was going to be open, and that defender got there a lot quicker than he thought he would.
Faithful is rejected by Brown, who went to the Raptors and cleaned house. Whistle inside. And they call a foul on Tawaski King, his third. Early foul trouble for the big fella. Catamount's up four, 3:23 to go here in the first half from the Ramsey Center. Center, the Catamount lead is four, but offensively, Wofford has struggled. A lot of that from the Catamount defense, but where Wofford's really picked it up and cut this lead is on the defensive side of the floor, forcing Sumler into some uncharacteristic mistakes.
A little more hustle, I believe. I mean, you have to hustle to pull off double teams effectively, and you come into a road environment, and this is not the easiest place to play in the world on most nights in the SoCon, but you got to weather the storm. And it looks like they have weathered the storm. Now they've got Tawaski in foul trouble, and we'll see if that helps out their offense any.
Coach Mike Young, a lot of you may remember the comments he had after he played here a year ago. Cochran, a long three, popped in and out.
Coach McCollum coaching his guys on the bench. He was not happy with what he saw on that defensive
Ross
possession.
Walked with it. And Coach Q going up and down the bench on the far side.
He's still going off, Kyle. I mean, that mouth was moving at 100 miles a minute. And
but going back to Coach Young, and I was talking with radio announcer Gary Ayers about this earlier today. In the preseason, Coach Young was talking with Gary. He said, yeah, I knew I'd probably take a little flack for that comment. He said, but, you know, he said, there's some things I like about it, too. He said on weekend games he likes to come up here and go fishing. He said, bottom line, to your point, Ryan, this is a tough place to come in here and get a win just about every time you're going to tip it off in the Ramsey Center.
Well, there's this strategic placement of this thing called the Cat House Band. And they take pride in coming up with some of the worst things they could possibly say to another human being, and can create quite a distraction there.
Catamount offense back to work. Cochran has done a very fine job on Trey Sumler, too. Shot clock down to 11 as Sumler calls out the offense. Ross catches high post off a screen. Tankowitz, well short. Might have been partially deflected. Now on the break, Tankowitz fouls him hard, and he'll go to the line. And if you're Tommy, not a very good shot. And then you got to make sure you get back and don't give up the easy one on the other end.
And that's
Skinner, a good job getting back.
That's exactly what Tom really didn't do there. I mean, he does get back and fouls him, but he's so focused on the fact that, oh, my shot got tipped, that he's not focused on getting back past half court.
And I believe Coach Hunter was absolutely irate at the officials. And he called timeout for a moment. I thought they teed him up there on the far side, but there was something that Coach Hunter clearly didn't like. And I think it had to do with that ball screen. Boggs was getting held when he tried to come around that screen, and Coach Hunter was less than pleased, and he's still letting him hear it over there on the far side.
He's getting focused. He's on his feet now, but I don't know. Not a lot said during the timeout either. I think he took the timeout to talk to the refs more.
And
number 34, Lee Skinner at the line now, shooting two for the Terriers.
Skinner's at the line regardless. 23-19. With 2:12 to go, he hits the first. Skinner misses first two attempts from the line here tonight. Gets that one to go. He's perfect on this trip, 2 of 4 now. And the Catamount lead down to 2. And see if the Catamount offense can find that rhythm they had early on in this one. Sumler in trouble, hangs in the air, can't get it to go. Brown the rebound. Off the window, a nice finish. Mike Brown, a big play there for the purple and gold.
Heads up play, a little bit of confusion there on Wofford's part, not boxing out, and Brown took complete advantage of it.
Faithful, nice pass, Skinner again. No call on the inside. I thought he got bumped by Tankiewicz. No call, as you said. The officials really letting a play. Tankiewicz with a right hand. Won't go. Ross the dunk won't go. Tankiewicz back up off the window. Won't go. Loose ball. Ross has got it. And finally, the ball goes out of bounds to Wofford. What a frantic possession that was.
Collins is hurting a lot. Looked like a knee. He went down over on the other side of half court. Obviously, they're not going to blow the whistle because it's Western's possession. Coach McCollum was on his feet cheering on the team, but hopefully he's okay.
But I think Tankiewicz on this end, on that drive, he really caught Wofford off guard. Because you scout him and you say, okay, he's a spot-up shooter. As Brown, the turnover, and he's blocked. What an emphatic block from Cochran. My goodness, he flew out of nowhere.
Heck of a play by Brown to get the steal, but I don't think he was expecting that. I mean, he goes up hard, and it just gets rejected. Nice, clean block.
Ross drops Sepp off the window. That one was blocked. Terriers are flying from everywhere, deflecting Catamount shots. And a 2-second differential between shot and game clock. And a foul called underneath. And that's Tankiewicz's third foul. So he and King both with 3. And now the shot clock is off with 28 seconds to go. And Wofford in the bonus will send Faithful to the line for a 1-1.
Little less of a big deal with Tank because he can play less aggressively on the perimeter. To have your big man down 3 with all the contact that goes on down low, that's tough. For a perimeter player that plays at the 3-point line all the time, you still don't want it, but you can manage with it.
Also subbing in for Wofford, number 31.
I'll tell you what, we're seeing some athletic plays defensively. I mean, there's some, usually the Cats are the smaller but more athletic team. Here tonight, I mean, both teams are about the same size and there are athletes all over the court.
Faithful gets the first, lead down to 3. Catamounts will have 28 seconds once this ball is in play after Faithful's second free throw. Second is also good, and Coach Hunter is going to take a 30-second timeout to talk about it. But I tell you what, that play by Cochran on the defensive end on that block from Brown, you could argue it's a 4-point swing in favor of the Terriers.
That was something else, but I mean, then you follow it up. Ross thinks he's got an easy 2, and that gets tipped aside with the fingertips. I mean, guys are getting up there.
As for the Catamounts offense here, where do you think they look to go Tankwitz King out of the ball game with three fouls. If you're Coach Hunter, who are you trying to get the ball for this last possession?
He's still got Tank in, probably for the reasons that I was getting at. It's a little easier for him to stay out of foul trouble. That's tough to say. I think they're going to work it around the perimeter. I'm sure he's got some sort of play drawn up, obviously, hence why he took the timeout. But Preston Ross, great player down low, but not the best ball handler in the world. I don't think they're going to look to work it inside out here. I think they're going to keep it on the outside.
Sumler brings it across the timeline. The clock hits 20, and he'll just dribble out there until the clock winds down.
We've seen this before, Kyle. Everyone in the stadium knows what's coming here.
Down to 10. Sumler called for the isolation. Wofford with fouls to give. A clever strategy from Coach Young. Catamounts will have to inbound again, and the Terriers can do that three more times here with 7 seconds to go.
Heads up, but you don't necessarily want to do that because of the personal fouls.
And now the fans are irate, and I think they might have a point. It looked like Sumler was trying to shoot. They said it was on the floor. A really heads-up play from Sumler, but he didn't get rewarded for it.
Yeah, it was a heads-up play from Sumler, but
And a technical foul called on Coach Hunter. My goodness, the turn of events here. I think Coach Hunter had a really legitimate point that Sumler went up for a shot, and he is irate at that official, and he got teed up for it. Now Cochran will get two free throws for Wofford and try to tie this ball game.
But the reason why he got teed up, Kyle, was because he's been going off earlier in the game, and the refs are tired of hearing it. At some point, when the ref looks at you, makes the call with a force behind it, and starts up play again, you just got to sit down. I mean, he's not going to change his mind, not when he's giving you that kind of body language.
The biggest roar of the night comes when Cochran misses the first technical free throw, and he missed both of them. My goodness, this crowd won't let him forget about that one for a while, as they just came to life for those free throws. It's still Catamount ball, 4.4 seconds to go, and they still have a two-point lead.
Six-man award. This place isn't even packed tonight, but they were loud, that's for sure.
Sumler with two, coming with one, fouled and one! Trey Sumler counted and a foul! Are you kidding me? Hangs in the air, he's fouled. Made no doubt there was a shot this time. He'll go to the line for a chance at a four-point play.
And that's why you give Trey free throws when he deserves free throws. You give this kid a chip on his shoulder, and he goes out and does things like that.
Somebody call up ESPN Top 10, because I think you'd be hard-pressed to find one better in the world of college basketball tonight. That was absolutely phenomenal.
Wow. That's something, too. You can criticize him for taking bad shots occasionally as he misses the free throw. But, I mean, when he can make shots like that, you kind of understand why he throws it up at times.
He can't get it to go, but he will leave the half with this crowd abuzz. Talk about your turnover from point swings. Cochran misses two technical free throws. Normally on the year, Cochran is 78% shooter from the line. Now he comes out. Sumler gets fouled while hanging. I don't know how he got the look to go. Hangs in the air, gets the three ball to go, goes to the line. And after all that, the Catamounts are up 28-23 at the break.
And I think they'll take that, but I don't know how he got that off. I mean, he's at half court with less than 4 seconds left, pulls a spin move. That's another second off the clock. And basically diving towards the three-point line by the time he got it off, and he basically swishes it. Like, there wasn't a lot of bouncing on the rim or anything there. That wasn't a lucky roll. He put that right on the money. That was, I don't think I've seen anything quite like that in this center since a couple years ago when they beat App.
As if this crowd wasn't fired up enough, Purple Thunder will take center stage when you come back for your halftime festivities. Catamounts lead by five. We'll see you on the other side.
Join us in making a difference. For more information, call 2013 production is entitled Hit the Lights, and it features music by some of today's hottest stars. CeeLo Green, Jay Sean, LMFAO, Lil Jon, The Pump DJs, T-Pain, Neo, and Pitbull. The group is written for and instructed by WCU Assistant Director of Athletic Bands, Mr. Matt Henley. The cheer team is coached by Mrs. Kim Cherry Beck and Mr. Eddie Wells. The dance team is instructed by Mrs. Jessica Granning and Amy Manshack. Purple Thunder section leaders this spring are Justin Holmes, Hunter Black, and Curtis Hoffman. The ensemble is coordinated by student staff coordinator Mrs. Lane Marshall and is supported by the Pride of the Mountains Marching Band. And now, ladies and gentlemen, get on your feet and stay there because it's time to feel the thunder.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the Ramsey Center as we get set for the second half. And Trey Sumler leading the way on both teams with 8 points, and he really gave the Catamounts a big spark they needed going into the locker room.
I still don't know how he made that. I mean, like I was saying, you got 4 seconds left to work with. You get it at half court. You pull a spin move. That takes about a second off the clock. You basically dive goal line style towards the three-point line and try to throw up something. Really a prayer. But it didn't even look like a prayer. It looked like he knew what he was doing and just, like, you know, did that back on the streets when I was, like, 8, you know.
He made it look a lot easier than it was. That is for sure.
Normal backyard basketball there. I mean, I don't know what that was.
The Catamounts out-rebounding the Terriers. 8 offensive boards for the Catamounts. That has been a point of emphasis, and they've succeeded there in the first half.
Certainly, and, I mean, it's just it's one of those things where you mentioned it in pregame, Kyle. This Cats team is good, but this Cats team has really struggled with playing 40 minutes. I think that's got to be Hunter's focus in the second half, his focus through halftime. Guys, we played a good first half. We're in exactly the position we want to be. Do the same things. Let's win the game.
Catamounts have 14 points in the paint compared to Wofford 6. Score has been tied 3 times. We've had 2 lead changes. Western's largest lead was 8 at the 6:30 mark. Wofford led by 1 with 17 and a half to go. But really, since then, it's been sort of back and forth throughout the ballgame. What's the key for both teams to come out with a W when the clock hits double zeros at the end of the second half?
Cats got to find a way to draw some fouls, I think. Thought the refs really were letting players play early on in the game. As the game went on, I think the Cats were starting to take a few calls that they don't need to take. Maybe not getting a few calls they should, and Larry Hunter let the refs hear about that and got a call himself. But, you know, I mean, you don't want to focus too much on that. Kind of just got to roll with the punches. But if they can get to the foul line a little bit, because, I mean, honestly, they've hit the ones that they've had. They only made it to the foul line 3 times in that first half, though.
So it's Wofford basketball. King and Tankowitz both in the ball game, both with 3 fouls. That is your foul trouble if you're the Catamounts. Wofford will start with the ball. And Catamounts blitz the wing. Hanger in the air, won't go. Tip won't go. Tankowitz, another rebound, and he has done a nice job on the glass, his 6th board.
He's got enough size to do it from a really a shooting guard standpoint. It's kind of interesting. He's more of a small forward size player as opposed to Sinclair.
King, his Tim Duncan impersonation, Mr. Fundamental with a bank off the window.
Nice shot right there.
Lead back to 7, and Wofford will bring it into the front court. Skinner hands off Cochran. Now they'll slide it outside. And now back into Skinner, backs down Boggs. Boggs had none of it. Skinner gets his own miss and gets it out of a trap. And Wofford will set it back up. Cochran, the creator for the Terriers, will take a shot and knock it down. As he knocks it down, a step inside the line.
Well, if he's not at the free throw line with no one around him, he's pretty good. He's hit about everything he's taken except for wide open shots with no one within 5 feet of him. So
Tankowitz, a dime to Boggs, but contact knocked him off balance. Now pump and go. Towoski going to work again, blocked from behind. Gets his own miss, and now he's fouled. Second go-around as Smith got him the second time. Got a clean block the first go-around, not the second time. And King will go to the free throw line.
Good fight from Towoski, and that's something that I think fans have really wanted to see out of him, that ability to go up hard. You don't get the calls down low in this league if you don't go up hard. That time, almost lost it the first time, managed to handle it, went up hard the second time, drew the foul.
This will only be the 4th and 5th free throw attempts for the Catamounts in this one. Wofford 7 of 12 from the line in the first half, and at 58%, they got to be kicking themselves a little bit that they could have narrowed that gap at halftime if they had made a couple of the freebies from the charity stripe.
And certainly. They're only down by 6 right now, and they missed 5 free throws in the first half.
Towoski King splits them. And the Catamounts are 3 of 5 from the stripe. And lead by 6 with 18 to go. Cochran, a floater in the air. A nice play driving baseline. And he cuts the lead back to 4.
Grinning and sticking his tongue out a little bit at that one. He's starting to feel it. They're going to have to tighten up defensively around him.
Sumler hanger in the air. That won't go. May have forced it a little bit. And Wofford coming back strong the other way. All the way baseline. Lays it in off the glass. Collins, a nice kiss off the window.
That's too easy, Kyle. I think Box has to take a body right there. Even if you take the foul, it's better than just giving him an easy deuce.
Gave up the baseline and it cost him. 2-point lead. King the ball and he was held on the inside. So the Catamounts will inbound the basketball, a fresh 35. It's Skinner's first. Inbounds comes to Tanglewitz. He'll drive baseline, swing it out Sinclair. Nice pass to Sumler, working baseline off the window is good. And Trey Sumler again, showing you that phenomenal body control while in the air to adjust it, make sure he got a good angle, squared up and knocked it down.
Good hop to get inside and Skinner just couldn't cover it.
Big bucket for the Catamounts as the Terriers have cut it to 2. Lead now 4. Faithful into the lane. Layup too strong. Sumler saves it. Boggs is able to receive the pass. Catamounts into the front court.
Chancellor Belcher liking that. All up on his feet behind us.
Boggs, nice crossover dribble. Hanger in the air. Brandon Boggs, a nice little bucket with a one-on-one move.
Cat's starting to get that rhythm going again here, playing very good on the defensive end and starting to get some buckets to go down for him as well.
Lead extended to 6. After Wofford had that 4-0 spurt, Catamounts have been all over him defensively. As the ball's knocked out of Collins' hand out of bounds. And Brown will check into the ballgame. Tanklewitz will come out. Skinner drops step into the lane. Can't get it to go. Boggs made him alter in the air to avoid the charge. And it may have forced the miss. Cochran pumps and goes all the way to the rack. Too strong. King a big rebound. Sumler on the break. Loose ball on the floor. Sinclair's got it. Out to Boggs. Drives, he'll hang in the air, offensive foul. Boggs took one dribble too far, and the action is fast-paced to say the least here in the second half. Catamount lead is 6 when you come back. Catamount All Access, presented by TV62. Welcome back to the Ramsey Center. It is a 6-point Catamount lead, and Ryan, you really have liked the defensive intensity that the Catamounts have showed, which has helped lead to the 6-point advantage.
Well, it just makes it so hard to play offense because, I mean, you got guys in your face just 24-7. It takes a toll on you. It starts to wear you out offensively, and you don't want that, and it doesn't give you any time to think. Hard to set up passing plays, and Wofford's had trouble handling it here today.
And right out of the gate, Catamounts come with some more full court pressure out of the timeout. Good denial that time from Sinclair, and Wofford will have to reset. Catamounts show a trap here. They lob it over to Skinner. Now a three ball on the way. That'll go. A big time shot from Collins, and Wofford really needed that one.
Boggs not happy with himself there. Lost his man, and his man made him pay.
Kings had a good start to the second half. He'll kick it back out. Cross court pass. Brown the recipient. Shot clock hits 10 as Sumler catches it. Top of the key, now he'll drive with 8. Fadeaway jumper, got it to go. Trey Sumler creating his own offense.
He's feeling it, and I don't mind that at all. When the shot clock's winding down, he's got the ability to drive and get separation, which he did right there, make a good shot.
Catamount showing a little bit of a matchup zone. Trying to get a trap and make Wofford uncomfortable handling the basketball. Cochran will have to put it up with 4. Ugly shot, and Brown rebounded the ball, but he stepped out of bounds.
Almost would have been better off just letting the ball go out of bounds, which is where it was heading. Of course, Brown didn't know that, obviously. He thought he was a free safety out there just going for the pick and didn't watch his feet.
And the official conference, and now they're going over to the scorer's table, making sure they reset the shot clock. Only 2 seconds for Wofford. They said Brown never had possession. So it's got to be a quick shot for the Terriers.
That's a good call. He landed right out of bounds.
Air ball again. Sumler not out of bounds. Sinclair spots up for the triple. No good. Brown, a nice rebound. Sumler, and we have a skirmish. Look out, ladies and gentlemen. Technical fouls issued both sides. Hunter is furious, and I think he's mad at Trey. Or the official. He's been in there enough.
He's upset with the official, and
I don't blame him.
I think
he's mad. It's a double technical. But it was clear that Faithful for the Terriers initiated that whole debacle on the inside, and this could be an issue too where they may go to the monitor to look. They can do that if they choose. We will have to see what the official word is. Neither coach looks particularly thrilled at the moment, Coach Young or Coach Hunter. It'll be a foul on Faithful, his second. And then we have a technical foul on Sumler and along. So Sumler's the only one that picks up a technical, and I'm not sure that I can understand that at all. Faithful did not make a play on the basketball.
Well, Faithful didn't. The intent's not there for Faithful to get a technical. I will say that. He did kind of twist him around a little bit. He's just trying to stop him from driving. That's a hard foul. I do have a problem with the technical because Sumler, literally, all he did was throw in a forearm trying to get Faithful off of him. Didn't throw a fist, didn't do anything like that. I think that's blowing the whistle on that way too early.
The second technical free throw, or technical foul in this ball game, one on Coach Hunter. Collins gets them both to go. The lead is now 3. Now the Catamounts will come. And Now there's all sorts of confusion. Wofford wants the basketball because of the technical foul. But I'm not sure that that's the right play here either, because they did call the foul on Faithful.
Interesting.
Catamounts, I think, at the sour end of the apple patch of that one. They lead by three. Skirmish on the floor, loose ball. Jump ball. Possession arrow to the Catamounts. And I'm going to tell you what, Ryan, the officials better get hold of this one in a hurry, because if they're not careful, this game, the way it's gone the last couple minutes or so, could really get out of hand.
I mean, we could always call technicals on jump balls as well. I mean, why not? But, no, I saw Sumler and Cochran talking there, just kind of joking around with each other. I don't think things are getting too heated on the floor. I think the Catamounts are more frustrated with the officiating at this point.
A foul away from the ball and a bit of sarcastic applause from the crowd here at the Ramsey Center. And now they'll inbound the basketball.
Wofford foul on number 34, Lee Skinner, his second personal.
Skinner's second.
Fourth team foul.
As Sinclair looks to inbound the ball, nice touch pass right back to him. He's hammered. And he'll go to the line. My goodness, if he had got that to go, the roof might have come off the place.
Well, he's fired up enough about the miss. I mean, I can't imagine how he would have celebrated if he had made it. Big play there. You see the athleticism from Sinclair to be able to get up, and he was about to slam it home. Just couldn't finish the play.
He might have taken the rim off the backboard there, Ryan. He was up there for a while. Can't get the free throw to go. So the Catamounts now struggling a little bit from the charity stripe when they have gotten there. As Sinclair on the season, a 72% free throw shooter, missed the first.
Both teams under 60% from the free throw line, and he misses both.
0 of 2, and a lot of coaches will tell you that's just as good as a turnover. Wofford into the front court. And Brown almost had a steal. Good hustle, and I really like the play of Mike Brown today. He has been all over the place for this Catamount team, especially on defense.
Trying to earn his minutes, Kyle. I mean, you bring in bench players, and when you have talent in your depth positions, they're going to come out and fight hard because they want those minutes. He's played well.
Cochran drives baseline, nothing there. Loose ball, corralled by Sumler. Sumler crosses up, Cochran kicks it out. Brown back to him. Sumler will try for the three, off the mark. Sinclair's tip won't go. Loose ball, Sumler's got it again. Another 50-50 ball to the purple and gold. Sumler throws it behind Boggs, that could be trouble. Cochran, he's fouled.
Good boy.
And it'll go to the line in there. They're like bowling pins over there by the cheer squad. Faithful takes a tumble right by Cochran. Nobody touched him. And we talk about the strategic placement of the Cat House band. Not in the end of the floor. You want to just slip and fall if you're a terrier.
It's just unfortunate. I mean, you got two guys go down on the court, so there's sweat all over the place. He came in hard and just slipped. I mean, let's cut him a little bit of slack there. Cochran thought it was funny, though.
You know, that looks like something I would do.
Oh, that's definitely something you would do, but there wouldn't be any sweat on the floor when you did it. But I think the only one that didn't see the humor in that was Indiana. He got up. He didn't look too happy at all.
Cochran knocks down the first.
But to give Brown credit, great effort defensively, because you don't want to give him the easy two there. Make him earn it from the stripe.
Free throw is good. Timeout, Wofford.
The Terriers are using a
30-second timeout. We'll keep it here. And the intensity, if nothing else, in this game has really picked up the last couple of minutes. Lead down to one. What do the Catamounts have to focus on? And what do you think their focus is in this timeout?
I think they got to take care of the basketball first off. But secondly, you're getting open shots and you're pump faking. Someone take the shot. I mean,
Tom Tankiewicz is not the only guy that can shoot a three-pointer. You hit on the last possession. Sumler comes down, drives, sees that he's going to get doubled, does exactly what I was talking about earlier, which is find the open man. That's Brown. He's wide open, and he passes up the shot. Sets up Sumler with a much tougher shot. If you're wide open, take the shot. Sinclair did earlier. He couldn't make it, but you got to keep on taking them.
Catamounts 3 of 7 from the free throw line. That has come to bite them a little bit here in the second half because they have gotten there in half number two unlike they did in the first.
Free throw shooting has not been pretty for either team. I mean, it's like we're watching the Los Angeles Lakers on both sides. I mean, it's just, it's bad. Really nothing else to say there. That could be the turning point in the game, though. If one of these teams can figure out how to make a free throw, like Cochran did right there, they might pull away.
So out of the timeout, the Catamounts will have the basketball up a point. And you get this sense, the Catamounts on a little bit of a drought, they need a bucket here.
I'd agree with that. They put Tom back into the game here. That'll help out possibly with the offense. They're going to keep Brown in. I like that. I mean, they look like they have a pretty solid lineup right here, but Trey's got to run the floor here.
Somewhere into the front court. Trying to get it into him on the low block. Knocked out of bounds. It'll stay here with the Catamounts. Catamounts will stack the floor. Tankiewicz tried to set him up with an open look. That pass over everybody's head. And a rush pass from Tankiewicz will result in another turnover. The Catamounts 8.
Got to bring that thing down. I think Brown wanted Towoski to jump for it, but I mean, just not a good pass. Wofford's starting to use that defensive pressure that we talked about with Western earlier, and it's working.
Spencer Collins makes it, and the Wofford Terriers have their first lead since 17 and a half to go in the first half. They lead it by one, 38-37. Catamount basketball. Boggs will swing it over to Skinner on him. Boggs will pull up for a jumper. That's too strong. And another good rebound for the Terriers. Skinner, his 8th board so far tonight. Looking for 3 more off the window, won't go. The bank wasn't open in Culloway for the Terriers. Tankiewicz again hesitates like you talked about on an open look.
He hasn't really been that open for the game, though. I've seen a lot more open that have just been completely passed up.
Fast break all the way, and that's going to be goaltending. Count the bucket. Terriers have their largest lead at 3. Count the bucket for Collins. Catamount basketball when you come back. 40-37, Terriers lead on Catamount All Access presented by TV62. Welcome back to the Ramsey Center. And while we can, Ryan, give us a quick SoCon score update from around the league.
Only a couple games going on tonight, Kyle. Samford currently beating Chattanooga about halfway through the first half. That's a 30-19 score. And then the nasty rivals from Boone beating Furman 15-8 with 12:32 left in the first half.
Thanks a lot, Ryan. Here, the score 40-37. Wofford has taken the lead. Catamounts have not had a bucket since the 14:39 mark. They've gone almost 4 minutes foul away from the basketball. But interesting note with that last foul. From now on, the Catamounts will be in the bonus, as the next foul will be Wofford's seventh here in this half.
Kind of a reverse of the first half. In this half, Western's been getting most of the calls, and like Wofford, they haven't been able to make most of their free throws.
Nice pass, Hankowitz! Slashes inside, they end the drought, and it's a one-point advantage for the Terriers. Tommy Tankowitz, a nice cut into the lane.
Yes, I owe Ross an apology. I said he wasn't the best ball handler earlier. He made a nice pass there.
Nice strong hands on the catch, and it went off Tankowitz's shoulder as nobody knew the pass was coming.
I think Tom actually got a hand on that. He saw the pass. The guy behind him had no idea.
So Collins inbounds the basketball. Skip pass. Now Collins will try the triple. Got it to go. Collins knocks down the triple. And he has had a nice ball game for the Terriers, his 16th point tonight.
I'd consider manning up at this point, Kyle. I mean, Collins continues to get open because Box keeps on leaving him. Yeah, you got to stay on your man.
Somewhere with the ball, shot clock down to 15, Catamounts down 4. Under 10 to go here in the ball game. Box thought about a triple. Now he'll drive. Nice laying off the window. So Box trying to avenge the bucket on the other end. The lead now down to 2. Cochran will try this time. There's 3 more. And all of a sudden, the Terriers are knocking him down from everywhere.
Certainly have picked up the play in terms of shooting. And the Cats just not able to keep up, as they've had a bit of a lid on the basket for most of the second half.
Wofford has made 5 three-point baskets all game long, 2 of them in their last 2 possessions. And now a costly turnover, the 11th for the Catamounts.
That's what I'm talking about right there, Kyle. Sinclair has an open shot, passes it up, and just throws a really bad pass. I mean, if you're going to pass it up, make sure you put it on the man, not 5 feet behind him.
A 5-point lead, and just like you said, Sinclair now will head to the bench. Three on the way, that one won't go, and that might be the best look they've had in the last 3 trips. Tankowitz now will bring it across the timeline, over Boggs' head, and another Catamount turnover.
He almost took out the dance team.
Last few possessions, the Catamounts have started to get really sloppy with the basketball.
That's the second errant pass that Tankowitz has had in the last 5 or 6 minutes. I mean, Coach Hunter's either got to calm him down or have him sit for a little while.
Good denial from Boggs that time. Ball's knocked out of bounds. Terriers will inbound under their own basket. 25 on the shot clock, 8:26 to go. Faithful gets the handoff, Brown on him. Collins again, he might have walked with it, got away with it. Shot clock down to 10, a good defensive series so far for the Catamounts. Faithful tries to split, pick and roll, fouled. And they're going to the line again, a nice, nice dish from Faithful.
That's good, solid play, and that's very good play from the Terrier, staying patient and not panicking. That is something that I've noticed throughout this game. When they get low on the shot clock, they don't panic. They just try to find a good shot, and they throw it up at the last minute if they have to. But they've made a couple buzzer beaters here in this game because they just stay calm.
Faithful at the line, shooting two. Or I beg your pardon, Skinner shooting two. Makes the first.
On the floor for the Catamounts, number 14, Josh Mendenhall.
And to bring up another thing, Kyle, that kind of composure out of a very young team. This Wofford team is used to winning, but when you look at their roster, it was mentioned in pregame, 12 of 14 players on this team are freshmen or sophomores. You got three sophomores and a freshman starting. I mean, it's a very young team, but already you can see that they stay composed.
Well, Coach Young on the Wofford sideline has a lot to say with that, too. Year in and year out, it seems this Terrier team's in contention. Somewhere hangs in the air. That won't go. Loose ball, Brown, guess who? And now he throws it away. What a hustle play, and he threw the ball away. Cochran for three.
He was worried about a backcourt
and
violation.
And over the back called. Sorry, Ryan.
That's fine. Brown worried about a backcourt violation there, and that's why he had to toss it. He just didn't put enough strength on it to get it to Mendenhall. On the other end, to talk about Wofford's youth again, that might be part of the reason why Wofford's coaching staff has been using a marker board to call plays. Not a lot of hand signals or anything like that. They literally just write their plays down on a marker board and just show it to the players.
Timeout. 7-point lead for the Terriers. Catamounts need a run. Under 8 to go. 7.5 to go when you come back. Back in the Ramsey Center where that last segment, the Terriers really took off shooting the basketball, and they now find themselves up 7. How do the Catamounts answer with 7.5 to go?
They got to start making shots. I mean, the Terriers right now really shooting really well from three-point line, so you got to stop that. Also shooting well from the foul line. They're 6-for-6 in the second half after having kind of a rough time in the first half. I mean, at this point, you can't send them to the line. You can't give them three-pointers because you're never going to catch up with them if you keep on doing that. And then offensively, you just got to stay patient and make those just like that.
Sumler, 4-1-1, connects on the first. As he gets set for the second, trying to cut the lead down to 5. Knocks that one down, and perhaps two of the less anticlimactic points he may have in the ball game, but very important ones nonetheless. Sumler now for the ball game has 14 and a foul on Mendenhall in the corner.
The Catamount fouls on number 14, Josh Mendenhall.
Just not a good foul to take, Kyle. I mean, he comes in aggressive, but he came in way too hot and just almost bowled the guy into the stands, really.
It'll be the fifth Catamount team foul. Inbounds pass comes in. Skinner, now Faithful, with Mendenhall in his shorts. And Collins had a little bit of trouble handling the ball, and I really like the move Hunter did. Puts Brown on him. Cochran knocks it down. And not a very easy shot, and Cochran made it look easy.
No, he's just feeling it at this point. They let him get into a rhythm, and he's going to be a problem for the rest of the night. They just got to find a way to keep up.
Cochran now with 17. Boggs, he'll try from three-point land, in and out, won't go. And a foul, and they're going to call it on Preston Ross on the inside.
Catamount foul on number 40, Preston Ross, his first. It's the 16th foul.
And it's the sixth Catamount foul. Only the first for Ross. The Catamounts again will bring on the full court pressure. And if there's an area offensively where Wofford has struggled this half, it has been a little bit with this full court pressure.
Well, they've struggled the entire game with it. I mean, it's been tough for them to handle. And at this point, the Cats have to get more aggressive. It's a good idea as they bring in to Wasp.
King checks back into the ball game as Ross will take a seat. Inbounds comes Skinner, and they work it back around to Faithful, who dribbles it across the timeline. 7-point Terrier lead. They're looking to build on that. Catamounts need to stop. Man, in the past couple minutes, Cochran with the basketball, a long way from the basket, and he has to give it up. Shot clock inside of 10. Wofford goes inside, right at Towoski. King can't get it to go. Got a really clean look, but couldn't finish.
That's a shot that really you'd expect to make. Good defense by the Catamounts.
Sumler almost lost it again. Now he has a Terrier scrambling, fouled, and he almost got another one to go. And normally I think you complain a little bit at him taking that shot, but I think he took it knowing he was going to get the contact, and now we'll go to the line.
I think he's fortunate he got the contact, Kyle, to be honest. That means
that's the criticism with Trey. He's a phenomenal athlete. He's a great player. He can do a lot of things for your basketball team, but the argument against him is that there's times that he doesn't trust his teammates, and he has talented teammates around him. I think there are times where you have to pass. However, in his defense, he has looked to pass today, and his teammates haven't taken shots that are open. So in that case, he's just looking to get the offense going.
They're bringing a towel out on the floor now, as it's a 50-44 Terrier lead. 5:57 to go. Sumler with one more free throw coming. And up to this point, the only Catamount in double figures, but a decent supporting cast. Boggs has 8. King with 7. And Sumler knocks it down. Now with 14 for him. And now the Catamounts need to try to get a stop on this end. Smith, skip pass. That one's tough to handle, and it's going to the Catamounts.
Good call.
And I tell you what, Skinner's not very happy, neither is Coach Young. Skinner let it go, thinking the Catamounts had touched the ball, but from our vantage point, it looked like it was clean, and the officials made the right call.
I don't know what he was thinking. It looked like it went off of his hand and just continued to bounce. I don't know why he didn't just pick it up.
King kick pass. Sumler will try the three. Got it to go. A big time shot. Sumler starting to try to take this game into his own hands. The lead down to 2.
Have to support the team. And the thing is, if you can make those shots, it's big. Right now, he's been able to do it all game long. Has had a big performance here tonight.
Faithful trying to shake Brown, not having a lot of success. And a 5-second violation, Catamount basketball. 4:54 to go, and I tell you what, Coach Hunter talked about just last week that he's looking for a player on this team to step up and be that lockdown defender. Mike Brown looks like he might be that guy.
Mike Brown's been fantastic today, and he's got this combination of aggression, being able to go for steals and stuff like that, but still able to stay in position. That's huge.
Sumler splits the double team, got the ball knocked loose. Still loose on the floor. Brown, guess who? He's on it again. Jump ball, and it'll be Terrier basketball. But again, another 50-50 ball that Brown is in there, in on the action.
Effort plays, Kyle. Effort plays. That's what he gives you. He's got the talent, but he's put in all the heart. And that has been big for this team. He's got this team back fired up. Him and Sumler both. You got the players and Coach McCollum on their feet over there on the sidelines a couple seconds ago. Fans are back into the game. They've got a little momentum rolling right now.
Skinner at the top, Boggs on him. Collins sees a blitz immediately. Skinner, he hesitates on a jump shot. Now backs down Boggs, tough shot. And not a very good shot compared to the look he had. And King will get it to somewhere. Catamounts down two, they bring in the front court. Catamounts now try to work the offense. Mendenhall over to Boggs, spin move. No foul called, and a tip. They say Cochran got a piece of it. Take a breath, because the Catamounts trail by two and are on the prowl with 3:57 to go when you come back to the Ramsey Center. Welcome back to a Ramsey Center that has all of a sudden awoken from hibernation. A two-point lead for the Terriers, but the Catamounts really have made a push in the last couple minutes.
Well, they peeled the lid off the basket, Kyle, started getting their offense going again and started calming down and playing better defense again, which is what got them the lead in the first place. They're going to have to keep on doing it, try to force a few more turnovers and see what they can get here.
Catamounts have not lost to the Terriers here since 2001. Look to keep that streak alive here. 10 on the shot clock. Tankiewicz can't get it to go. Loose ball and a foul called on Brown. Yeah. And it will result in a 1-1 for the Terriers.
Foul number 2, Mike Brown. That's his second personal.
His second.
And
a big 1-1 here if you're Wofford, because if you miss it, you give the ball right back to the Catamounts and put pressure right back on your defense.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I'm not sure if I agree with that call. It didn't look like there was a whole ton of contact. Contact came in from behind, though, and that might be why the whistle was blown.
Good news if you're the Terriers. Cochran, a good free throw shooter at the line, even though he's only 2 of 4 here today. That one pops out. The colorway iron unkind to the Terriers, and down the stretch we come. 3:35 to go and rolling. Catamounts down two, but with the ball. King trying to back his way in there, now hands it to Sumler. Back to Tinkowitz, pump fake. Shot clock under 10, can Sumler create again? Tinkowitz over to Boggs. Takes a step inside, can't get it to go. And Ryan, I think I agree with you on that one. Boggs has to take it off that pass and shoot immediately.
Tank also had a shot earlier that he decided to pass up. I mean, no one but Sumler on this team wants to shoot right now.
And offensive foul, yes sir, he hooked around him. And Brandon Boggs, I think, frustrated himself as he slaps the padding under the basket as he gets set to inbound the ball, but a good call from the official is, I tell you what, he had an arm full of Brandon Boggs and Skinner. A little swim move down on the low block.
Unfortunately for him, that's not allowed.
Tell you what, on the gridiron, it's usually a pretty good play.
Oh, it's a great play, but not here.
Not on the hardwood. 2.5 to go, pass deflected, King gets it back. Triple teamed, left-handed hook goes! He out Nope, thanks to Terrier defense that time, we're tied at 50.
Go get him, big fella. This is the Zawoski King that people have wanted to see. He has worked hard to develop into a good player both offensively and defensively, and you're starting to see a guy that could be a dominant force down low, especially against some of these smaller players. With Wofford has really taken advantage tonight and had a very solid game.
Brown thought he picked Faithful's pocket, but official calls a foul. Faithful at the line, a 1-1. Tied at 52, 12 to go. First one, he got it to go. Terrier lead is one. And with that free throw, Faithful, 3 of 4.
Well, Sumler and Cochran have been talking to each other the entire game, and Cochran's been laughing half the time. I mean,
and
guys making
is good. Coach Young will take a timeout.
Wofford is using a 30-second timeout.
So, Ryan, we got 2:12 to go, 52-50. Two big free throws from Faithful, and you got to think Trey Sumler is going to be very involved in the last 2:12.
Certainly, but I mean, Sumler's just talking down there nonchalantly with the other team. It's like there's budding friendships going on in the middle of a hotly contested game. I kind of like it, actually. I think it's good sportsmanship in the SoCon, obviously, but also it shows that right now, Catamounts are a little loose right now. They got a little tightened up early in the second half, but they've been in this situation before, and now they need to prove that they can win in this situation. And I think Trey's ready to go do it.
And you got to think, too, the Catamounts have had lots of games like this close, hanging in there right to the wire. They've been in a lot of games with 2:12. If they can finish one, you think you could catapult the last half of this season. And I think part of them playing loose, as you mentioned, is Sumler will try another triple. Give him all three of those. The Catamounts have regained the lead. Are you kidding me?
That's beautiful basketball, Kyle. I mean, Boggs drives inside. That opens up the lane. He makes a perfect pass to Sumler, and no hesitation. Finally, we see a shot with no hesitation. He caught the ball. It was up.
Trey Sumler now with 22 points. And I think a lot of the part why Cochran and Sumler are laughing, I think they even realize that what they're doing is pretty special here tonight.
They're putting on a show. I mean, and the thing is, too, Sumler was matched up with Indiana Faithful for most of the first half, and they've matched him up head-to-head with Cochran here in the second, and these two are just going point for point right at each other, and it's been a show. It's been very fun to watch.
Sumler only 8 points in that first half, but obviously the circus shot at the end of it, which gave him 3 of 8, and since then he has been on an absolute tear here in half number two.
He's been shooting a little bit more here in the second half as well. He was looking to facilitate in the first half and realized that some people just don't want to shoot tonight, so he's taking the team on his shoulders. He's done a heck of a job.
Cochran can't get this one to go. Guess who with the rebound? It's Brown again. What can Brown do for you if you're the purple and gold? He gets you a lot of hustle plays.
He keeps his feet in bounds that time too, Kyle.
90 seconds to go. Catamounts lead by one. Sumler's going to milk some of this clock. And why not? I tell you what. I don't see how you can't let Sumler at least have a chance at getting another basket. Circus shot, Cochran blocked him. Holy cow, what a show they're putting on.
Just two supreme athletes going head to head, and what a game this has been. But then the matchup just between the two of them has been something to behold.
Swing it over, Cochran will try it again. Got it to go, back and forth. Who will have the last laugh? Catamounts down one. Under a minute to go. Catamounts are working. Can anyone step up beside Sumler? King will come to set a screen for him. Hesitation dribble. Now he goes. Floater off the window. Are you kidding me? My goodness, this is absolutely ridiculous.
Defense has to play here, though, Kyle. Wofford's going to wait
Proud
for the last shot.
20 to go. Catamounts lead by one. Floater good. and a timeout called by Wofford. And the Terriers get someone to step up. Collins, a little teardrop. 16 seconds to go, and Ryan, talk strategy if you're Coach Hunter, down one with 16 seconds.
Let's talk strategy from Wofford. Too much time. You cannot give Trey Sumler 16 seconds left with a one-point deficit with a team that's been denied all year long in close games. You're going to give Trey Sumler a chance to win it. You know what he's going to do. He's going to do what he did in the first half. He's going to take that ball straight around the backcourt line, the half-court line, rather. He's going to dribble it out to around 8 seconds left. He's going to put a couple moves. He's going to throw up a shot.
16.2 to go. The obvious pick you would think is Sumler, but if it's not Sumler, who is it for the Catamounts?
It's Sumler. There is no other pick. I mean, unless Wofford quintuple teams him and there's four guys wide open, it's going to be Sumler.
Well, I tell you what, 16.2 to go, 56-55, and with the exception of that last bucket, the last 2 minutes have really been the Cochran-Sumler show.
I tell you what, though, students that didn't attend this game, there's quite a few of them. They're just missing out, Kyle. This has been back and forth, close from start to finish. It's been quite an action-packed game, very fast pace, and both teams really deserve a win here tonight. They have left it out on the court for sure.
Sumler will bring it across the timeline. Clock down to 10. Down to the wire we go in the Ramsey Center. Clock at 5. Sumler's got to make his move. Jump shot. Good! Are you kidding me? Trey Sumler with 2.3 to go.
And here's what makes Trey so special, Kyle. They know what's coming. And he still gets separation and hits the shot. He was open. They know that it's coming, Kyle. And they can't stop it.
But Cochran has 2.3 to go if you're the Terriers. It doesn't get any better than this between the Terriers and Catamounts. Trey Sumler has done just about all you can ask a guy to do tonight. But so is Cochran. And Cochran with a chance to get the last lap. His team down one. If you're the Catamounts, you commit extra people, knowing that Collins and Skinner have also played very well for the Terriers.
Well, you got to be careful here because, A, you can't foul because that'll send him to the line regardless, and then two, three free throws and the game's over.
So you've got to play clean, but, yeah, you don't want to give Cochran that open shot. But
Cochran,
you are right.
Other and Sumler have gone off in the last 3 minutes, 2 minutes. And here we go. 2.3 to go. Wofford inbounding from on the other side of the floor. Heaves it in. King knocks it away. The game is over. The Catamounts win a close one here in the Ramsey Center. Trey Sumler with a knockout blow. And what a performance it was from number 5 in white.
How about it? Trey Sumler on offense and then the rest of the Cats on defense. James Sinclair coming up with some big plays. Mike Brown, the underrated player of the game, really. Tawaski King, really a very impressive performance from him. It's going to get swept under the rug a little bit because of how big Sumler came up, especially there in the second half. But Tawaski King, big game today. And in a game where Tom Tankiewicz really struggled, to be honest, the team managed to fight through it and come away with, wow, what a victory for the Cats. This is huge going down the stretch.
This is an absolute monster win if you're the Catamounts, a team that hadn't won the close ones. They do here tonight. And as the team makes their victory lap, Ryan, this was absolutely a sight to see as Sumler and Cochran went mano a mano all the way to the wire.
I'll tell you, and this whole thing about the RPI rating in the Southern Conference being 27th, forget it. These teams don't have the best records in the world, but they go head-to-head, they go hard, and you get some very good games. And here tonight, an instant classic here in Colway. What a game.
Both Catamounts plays. Get their first home win since January 12th against UNCG.
this win can catapult a run much like we saw last year in Ryan. I can't tell you how similar this looks to a year ago.
Certainly, and it's a game that they needed. They've got two road games coming up, one against Greensboro, who at home hasn't been terrible. They're 6-6. They've struggled on the road. And then they have to go to Elon, where they lost to Elon here. Elon leads the North at 16-8 overall, 9-3 in the conference. I mean, this is the type of momentum builder to prepare you for those two games. Then you come back at home against College of Charleston, try to wrap up the season, really. A couple other games, Coastal Carolina, and then Chat to end off the season. Oh, excuse me, Sanford will end off the season in March, but just big, big win, and the way they had to earn it, very impressive.
The Catamounts will improve to 7-6 in the Southern Conference. The Terriers will fall to 4-9. The final numbers for Trey Sumler, remember we told you he had 19 just inside the four-minute timeout. He ended up with 26 points and none bigger than the two he hit in the last minute. Cochran ends up with 19. And what a finish for Ryan Keyes. I'm Kyle Rush. It was a classic, everybody. Stay tuned for our post-game show. Caleb Rutherford, Jake Myers coming your way right after the break.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Ramsey Center for the Catamount All-Access Postgame Show. I'm Caleb Rutherford alongside Jake Myers. And Jake, what a finish.
It was absolutely spectacular. And we talked about in the pregame how Trey Sumler plays the entire game, basically. And thank goodness for the Catamounts, he did play pretty much the entire game down the stretch, and he hit one of the best shots we've seen this year.
Certainly very impressive shot. When the Catamounts needed him most, he stepped up and made the what was the game-winning shot. Sumler with 26 points, but does it alarm you a little bit, or a lot of it, if it does alarm you a lot? He was the only one in double figures for the Catamounts.
He was the only one in double figures, but if you look across the board, you have Tawaski King, 4 of 9, Tom Tankiewicz, 2 of 9, Brandon Boggs, 3 of 8, James Sinclair, 2 of 4. Now, those aren't necessarily the best point totals, and they didn't really take too many shots. Tawaski, 4 of 9, 9 shots is a lot, but he was pretty efficient with those 4 makes. Tom, he struggled from the field tonight, 1 of 6 on threes. Could have done a little bit better, but Brandon, 3 of 8, James, 2 of 4. That's pretty efficient from the other two guards. So it's not great to see guys not being able to pick up the slack because Trey having to do everything. But when Trey takes over like he can and like he did tonight, like we saw, I mean, there's no stopping Trey Sumler. There is just no stopping him when he's on his game.
And Trey spoiled a very good effort from Carl Cochran and Spencer Collins, two very talented young players for the Wofford Terriers. Cochran with 19 points, Collins with 18 points. Now, we talked about Wofford's youth, and the youth almost overcame the experience here tonight. Talk a little bit about how we talked about the youth in the pregame. How did that work in their advantage tonight?
Well, I mean, they just have fresh legs, I guess. Younger guys just being able to get after the ball, because as we see, Cochran, he played 37 minutes. Spencer, he played 33 minutes. So they got a lot of playing time. There's only four guys averaged almost 35 minutes for them this evening, and I don't know if they were just on their game more so than ever, but I mean, the kids were hitting the shots. Carl Cochran hit so many shots, and it was unbelievable. I was amazed the entire game of the shots he was hitting. He was not missing. He took 18 shots, but this team, they will continue to get better, because as we said, Spencer Collins, who had 18 points like you mentioned, is only a freshman. And they will continue to get better. They will continue to develop. And their coach has to be happy with their effort here, even though it was a losing effort. But we're proud of our Catamounts today.
Absolutely. Now, it's easy to say that Trey was the player of the game. Certainly he was. He had an outstanding effort. Aside from Trey, who would you say stepped up for the Catamounts tonight?
It has to be Tawaski King. I mean, 4 of 9. Pretty efficient, almost 50% from the field. 1 of 2 from the free throw line. Played 31 minutes. And he pulled down 6 rebounds. Now, Western out-rebounded the Terriers 35-26, and that was one of the keys I had coming into the game, mm-hmm. and they did that, and that was one of the reasons they got a lot of second-chance opportunities, even though they didn't capitalize every single time. But Tawaski King did his job. He stayed out of foul trouble for the most part, got a little bit in the first half, but second half did great defensively and did great down the stretch and got the ball to Trey Sumler. What can you say?
Certainly something I noticed. Tawaski King got involved a lot very early. They tried to get him the ball early and often. Something we talked about, him being of equal size to the biggest guys on Wofford's team, something Tawaski's not used to, and he looked like he did take advantage of it for the most part. And that's going to do it for the Catamount All-Access postgame show. Join us later this week. I believe on Saturday we'll have baseball, the first game of baseball against Washington State, I believe, is coming down. The Cougars are coming to visit us here. That'll be this weekend. Be sure to tune in and check this out. For Kyle Rush and Ryan Keyes, I'm Caleb Rutherford, and this is Jake Myers. Thanks for watching.